O divine saviour, arise upon the mountains of Albion as in ancient time. Behold, the cities of Albion seek thy face. London groans in pain from hill to hill, and the Thames laments along the valleys. The little villages of Middlesex and Surrey hunger and thirst. The 28 cities of Albion stretch their hands to thee because of the oppressors of Albion in every city and village. They mock at the labourer's limbs. They mock at his starved children. They buy his daughters, that they may have power to sell his sons. They compel the poor to live upon a crust of bread by soft, mild arts. They reduce man to want, then give with pomp and ceremony. Albion is sick, said every valley, every mournful hill and every river. Our brother Albion is sick to death. He hath leagued himself with robbers. He hath studied the arts of unbelief. Envy hovers over him. His friends are his abhorrence. Those who give their lives for him are despised. Those who devour his soul are taken into his bosom. To destroy his emanation is their intention. Arise, awake, O friends of the giant Albion. They have persuaded him of horrible falsehoods. They have sown errors over all his fruitful fields. The 24 heard. They came trembling on watery chariots, borne by the living creatures of the third procession of human majesty. The living creatures wept aloud as they went along Albion's roads, till they arrived at Albion's house.
By police in riot gear who are refusing to allow a mile-long hippie convoy to move.
Meanwhile, Liberal MP Paddy Ashdown, who's at the scene, has said the police had no right to block the road. The police had no right to block the road. The police had no right to block the road. The hippie's destination is still unknown.
Police in riot gear are preparing to use force to break up the West Country hippie convoy.
Police have told the 300-strong hippie convoy that unless it breaks up into small groups, it'll be broken up by force. The scene is now set for a possibly violent confrontation when police decide to move in.
Dorset Chief Constable Brian Waite says he doesn't want the hippies in his territory.
I really am not prepared to allow the convoy to proceed through this county. Local farmers are threatening to take action against them. I fear a breach of the peace, and for that reason, I cannot allow them to continue. Local farmers are threatening to take action against them, and for that reason, I cannot allow them to continue.
Firemen have put out a blaze at the main reactor building of the Sizewell nuclear power station in Suffolk. The fire broke out in packing cases.
Well, let me tell you, it's mine. It's mine.
They're back at buses and vans, don't have tax or MOTs, they live on the dole and their children don't go to school. The farmers don't want them on their land and the police aim to break them up.
Wiltshire police are rushing all available officers to Stonehenge, where at least 100 hippies have gathered in a nearby car park. It's exactly a year since police clashed violently with people determined to mark the summer solstice.
Many of the battered buses and coaches have run out of petrol. A police helicopter hovered overhead and 200 officers from four forces wearing protective clothing and backed up by armoured vans and dogs stood by. Earlier, I heard a senior officer tell a colleague unofficially that some of the travellers were arming themselves with machetes and stones, but there's been no evidence of that.
Forestry Commission land. No right to be here. I'm requesting you, on behalf of the Forestry Commission, to leave forthwith. If you do not do so, the Commission will take proceedings to be made.
she claims the law of principle that she has to. And Home Secretary Douglas Hurd says the convoy is nothing but a group of lawmakers.
It is anything but peaceful. Indeed, it resembles a band of medieval brigands who have no respect for the law or for the rights of others.
The High Court judge has decided that a hippie convoy can be picked up in New Falls, New Hampshire, and Mrs. Thatcher warns she's considering ways of stopping their bill money if they refuse work.
Well, the hippie peace convoy met its end at dawn this morning when 500 police moved in, arrested 42 people, and impounded over 100 vehicles.
The police moved in just as dawn broke over this New Forest duty spot. Hundreds of officers swarmed over the site, telling the hippies to go. Within minutes, each bus, truck and tent had been surrounded and searched. Owners of the 100 or more vehicles impounded tried to salvage a few belongings.
There wasn't any violence involved in the police operation this morning.
The police chief, who sent in 500 officers to break up the hippie camp in the New Forest, says his decision was justified because the hippies were harboring a violent group bent on trouble.
Hampshire's chief constable, John Duke, insists there are, as he puts it, evil warriors within the group.
Well, there are vehicles on that site owned, I think, by Mickey Mouse and Mouse the Nick. And this is the way these hard warriors survive, by synonymous strength. And indeed, some of them have their minds poisoned by authority.
A hippie convoy of about 60 vehicles is preparing to move off from its overnight stop in rural Wiltshire, and police from several forces were on standby in case they needed to force the convoy to move. And police from several forces were on standby in case they needed to force the convoy to move. And police from several forces were on standby in case they needed to force the convoy to move.
You can't just start shooting without having someone in the gun sights.
Justice hath heaved a sword to plunge in Albion's breast, for Albion's sins are crimson dyed, and the red scourge follows her desolate sons. Then Patriot rose. Full oft did Patriot rise, when tyranny hath stained fair Albion's breast with her own children's gore. Round his majestic feet deep thunders roll, each heart doth tremble, and each knee grows slack.
Half my friends are hippies, living in tents and trucks, camping in the winter, following the sun. Come down for the solstice, hang around the stone, but all they ever offer is military clones. Wiltshire police, Thames Valley Jew, Ministry of Defense, bloodthirsty mob of blue. Heavy, macho boys in uniform. Well, I used to love them, but it's on.
I mean, there was these rock festivals probably before Windsor. The first Windsor I went to was 1973. Windsor was a free festival, very much so. Windsor was literally on the side of the road. There was no inkling really of any problem. And suddenly, somebody's got hold of me, and it's a guy dressed as a hippie, if you like, and he's a police, he's saying, get off the site, get rid of your camps, and they're running on, and the next thing you know, you're looking over the hill, and there's this huge line of police. Uniform. this was quite a new thing, and they just moved onto the site and walked down the field. A lot of hassling, quite a lot of bullying, people were being dragged about. Oh, and I remember the Thames Valley got a terrific amount of flak for that. Then it started in the papers. And that's led the government at the time to actually feel, gosh, this is a little bit out of order. You know, and they had to recognise that there were a bunch of people that were going to Windsor and that they did exist and that they couldn't have a repeat of the previous year's performance with the Thames Valley Police. And in the end, they provided them with a site, OK? And that was Watchfield. But Watchfield, as I say, was this massive airfield, and they took over the conning towers and things. And it lasted for 9 days, as it turned out, which in those days was amazing. That was tremendous, really.
In uniform.
But parallel now, over in East Anglia, we've got the creation of the Barsham Fairs, where a bunch of people have decided to hold these medieval fairs. Barsham was the beginning of the Albion Fairs, the spirit of Albion. The whole Albion movement was beginning with Barsham. So everyone was encouraged to take part in this bygone thing. A lot of stalls and crafts and potters and events for children, loads of theatre groups. A local dance school, I remember, was involved. You know, you'd have beggars in the beer tent and very realistic, particularly if you had after a couple of pints of strong local beer. You know, people were caught up in this whole sort of amazing pageant, really. Knights in armour and people in sackcloth and jesters and jokers, and it was so well done, and the people of Suffolk and Norfolk contributed so much to that it was like going back in time. It was quite incredible. In the same year as Watchfield and Barsham, there was Stonehenge as well, a fairly small festival at Stonehenge, about 5,000 or 6,000 people on a site about half a mile from the stones. Again, with the permission of the farmer. In fact, we were in a situation where we were collecting money for him. And there was this guy, Wally Hope, who had this dream about England as perhaps it should be, and the whole thing that was around the stones and the Sun Temple and this place of homage where we were meant to be able to have access to and to be and to grow as a part of this whole powerful centre of energy, which Stonehenge obviously is.
We only wanted a festival. We didn't want to end up bashed. We didn't want the martyrs trashed. We didn't want our freedom slashed. We only wanted a festival.
TVs were starting to represent the structure of the whole movement at that time. TP's provided a real focus, I think, because you were on the earth all the time, and yet you were protected from the elements. And this is really quite a discovery, that you can actually live outside. You do not need to be closed in all the time and dependent on gadgetry. We wanted to create villages, actually, on England's green and pleasant land, and TP's represented this opportunity to do it, because they were relatively quickly constructed, they were easy to put up, and you could be living on the land. You didn't have to wait 5 years to build your house and get all the bricks and all the business. You could actually move onto a piece of land and occupy it and create a community very quickly. We had the means to actually sit on the land and present ourselves as a viable tribe or a viable group of people. And of course, this is very exciting when you suddenly see the possibilities of all this land in Britain, valleys, isolated valleys, and land which hadn't been used, really.
At a fair like this, you've got all members of the public, you've got mums and dads and children, very straight people, and you've got all sorts of people. The convoy are here, but what I felt would happen was that after a few years of being itinerant, the convoy would mellow and sort of, and they have. It's when they first escape from the city, you know, and they come out with all the sort of commercial exploitation and the aggravation of the city, really. And of course, the lovely thing in East Anglia was that we had fairs over at Ling, another group had fairs over at Bungay, another group had fairs at Bury St Edmunds, another group had them way down in Colchester. And we're all like different tribes, you know, and we all collectively bought the big top that's owned by all of us, all the different fair groups. And we were like one big sort of brotherhood, you know, sisterhood. And they used to go off to ancient sites and began to realise the people that built Stonehenge were not like the people that used to appear in Hammer films, weren't these barbaric savages, you know. And then felt that if people thousands of years ago had related to nature in that way, we were still the same people, we were still Homo sapiens, we hadn't mutated into anything else, that it was still possible to sort of get in touch again, and felt, without reading any books or getting into any sort of religions at all, that one just wanted to do homages to the sun or to the earth, the moon. I really began to feel, as I do now, you know, there is some sort of magic, telepathic connection between everything.
It's electrical. You know, it's like electrical energy in the body that you need that earth music. But most of us have got rubber sole shoes which insulate electrical energy. So we're almost disembodied from the earth. And you can bet your life that these people that are running nuclear power stations and all these big energy metamorphosis places rarely ever touch the earth. They're sort of, they're living in outer space almost because they've got no connection with the earth.
Albion were having sort of numbers, five or six fairs a year then at that time. More and more people starting to get not go home between festivals, move around in groups, move between two festivals in convoys or whatever, and stay on the road in the summer, just travel from one festival to another. Travelling in convoy in 76 was quite a number because nobody'd ever seen anything like it before, you know, and it was sort of van loads of people and the goats and everything was on the move. But there wasn't this sort of confrontation thing that there seems to be quite so much now. On one side, you've got the authorities who represent one way of life, and you've got the travellers and the festival goers and the freaks and the hippies and whatever you want to call them. The New Age gypsies representing or trying to find an alternative. We've gone into the 80s and we've got a different kind of social and political situation in this country than we had for the late 60s, early 70s. High-profile politicians, oppressive, reactionary policies, a lot of disillusionment amongst youngsters, and the punk thing, which was a dissatisfaction, probably, with the softness of the hippies and the peace and love, man, and bumble along, and brown rice and seaweed, and it'll all be all right. They wanted a bit more action, maybe. They were dissatisfied youth, they were unemployed, nobody was doing anything for them. They saw Britain perhaps with no future. I mean, again, these are just all the old cliches that come out. And so, obviously, some of these youngsters are now getting in onto the convoy thing and getting into the, festivals in the summer, this is a good scene, you know, get us out of the cities. Suddenly, buses became a focus. A lot of people had buses. They liked the idea. You know, you'd go one year and then next year there'd be double the number of buses. People are living in the middle of the year. They're finding park-ups all around the country. They're not living in squats in London anymore. They're living in buses. Park-ups are starting to be found. People are staying and finding places for the winter. But due to various factors, there's the paranoia has crept in, you know. People are talking about the convoy, the convoy, the convoy. They're starting to create this monster. They're feeding it, they're feeding it.
According to this guy at the office, signing on day for the so-called convoy is Thursdays, no matter where we are. And if you don't sign on Thursday, then you forfeit your money for the week. He said, I'll give you 3 days, and I wouldn't accept that. I said to him, how much is that? He said, £14, and I said, you're fucking joking. I said, you owe me £29.40 for this week. You owe me £29.40 for last week. and you owe me another 29.40 for the week before that. And he said, "How come?" And I said, "Well, that's what you owe me. End of story."
But again, you know, it's a lot of hassle, and they're very sort of abusive. Their attitude, they're making things very difficult. Yet without travellers and that, all these fruit harvests wouldn't get picked. I mean, there is a real need for a mobile sort of workforce like that with their own accommodation, because a lot of the farms haven't got accommodation. So they rely on people with caravans and mobile homes, etc., to, you know, do the work. So there is a real need for travellers.
The good are attracted by men's perceptions and think not for themselves till experience teaches them to catch and to cage the fairies and elves. And then the knave begins to snarl and the hypocrite to howl, and all his good friends show their private ends, and the eagle is known from the owl.
The true Albion knights, the little people and all that, to the Gaels. The Picts and the Celts were the first epoch after the little people. For the want of a better name, fairs and barter, fairs and fairy folk. So Carnac, they've got this two circles with, I suppose you could say it's an avenue. There's a straight line between the two circles, but it's not, it's almost been delineated by like fields and things like that. And the actual standing stones of Carnac from the rings run at like a tangent to each other. But they put so much energy into laying out those stones, a long fucking, there's about 16 different rows, all of these long straight lines of standing stones, all aligned the same way and all polarized, all crystallized. There's the channel, you know, the snake again, you see. It's head and tail, that, which is the Alpha Omega principle. So that's what they brought with them over to us, where we already had Stonehenge and Avebury. They brought the knowledge of Carnac, worship to our sides.
We're not so bad as people continually tell us that we are, you know. They're the fucking criminals. They're holding the world to ransom. It's only the spiritualization of the whole nature that can transform human society. Religion will never do it.
They're giving the same blurb about Amnesty International in the programme this year.
Prisoners of conscience in England. You've started to sort out
freedom everywhere else except for here.
Yeah, right. We're a different place, though. You know, we've got freedom of speech.
Providing you don't become effective.
From Bogart,
I think we should ask for an apology from Lord Elliot, and to make it public. They fucking evicted people from here last year that had their homes, mobile homes, albeit mobile homes, but still people's homes, you know, that were wantonly destroyed by the police at Savernake, and there was no room here for them. Could you explain your attitude, why you set up a festival to support Amnesty International? An organisation that supports people's rights of belief, and yet you would take out an injunction against 16 known individuals as members of Pagans in Britain.
There's no injunction outstanding here.
There was last year.
Different last year.
Yeah. Don't you think you owe those people an apology?
No.
You don't. I presume you're Lord Elliot, aren't you?
Could be. It's irrelevant.
Well, we're not playing games. I mean, we're just here to ask simple questions.
It's the tone in which you ask them. I'm prepared to discuss this thing in an amicable way.
Well, that's what we hoped for.
But the tone of your voice and your general stance and deportment is not conducive to civilised conversation.
What's my stance?
You are 100% certain that no donation has been received from the Elephant Fair or Lord Elliot or the Elephant Arts Co-op?
I have not received payment for the, most certainly for the 1985 contribution. I have a letter from them saying that it will be paid as soon as funds were available.
And that was for £2,000?
For £2,000 for the 1985.
All persons now here are trespassing, and you should now take immediate steps to remove yourselves, your vehicles and equipment from this site and from the Port Shadwell estate by 9 a.m. tomorrow. Wednesday,
30th
of July.
Yeah, I'm from BBC Southwest in Plymouth. And what's the story?
they've been asked to leave, they haven't left. We're often sent to cover those sort of stories, and that's it. All I was asking was whether we would be welcoming your group of people so that you could put your face, that's all.
How fair do you think any BBC coverage can be on a hit-and-run job like this?
I'm not a reporter, I'm not a journalist. I just have a job to do as a cameraman, that's all. I have to
say... Yeah, but, I mean, that's like saying I just follow orders.
Yes. I'm employed to do that.
Yeah, but surely when you're operating the camera, you're thinking more of what you're doing than just focusing it.
Well, if you'll excuse me, I've just got to go now.
Meanwhile, the last remaining people at the Elephant Fair are slowly leaving the site, and they say they'll be gone before Lord Elliot can serve an eviction notice. The festival goers say they'll move on as soon as they can get their lorries and coaches started, but they're refusing to say where they'll be going. They've been threatened with an eviction notice after around 100 hippies staged a sit-in.
It's magic, eh? Travelling in a bus. You can turn the music up, Marsha.
I was in first gear, I was just crawling into the car. And I was out the window and I was talking to the cop and I was saying, look, what do you want me to do? Where do you want me to go? And he said, we want you to pull over the side of the road so we can search you for drugs and offensive weapons. And I'm down to walking space, I'm leaning out of the driver's window, I'm talking to the policeman, and the cop tries to throw his handcuffs through the windscreen. And what am I supposed to do if this man in front of me is supposed to be the law of the land? Yeah? And he's trying to throw his handcuffs through the windscreen?
And the Tibetans opened up one of the first best garages in London. But a great place to do up your vehicle. It was really good. And they raided the place with 175 policemen at 6 o'clock in the morning. What you had no receipts for, they took your television if you had no receipt for it. I took a 2-year-old baby away from the father because the mother wasn't there. It was quite terrible. And the day afterwards, we had the BBC coming down, the radio coming down. Is there also the newspapers coming down, just constant hassle after that. People come and look at you as if you're sort of in a zoo, like.
The propaganda machine has made people who are travellers or who are out of order, who are thinking people, synonymous with terrorists.
It's basically the media that makes these people scared of us because of all these things that they say. That's one of the reasons why I had to go away from that, because I didn't want half of the English population to be scared of me because I was with a convoy. That was not the meaning. I didn't join up with the convoy to have the people who are not with the convoy to have them being scared of your life. That's not the reason why I joined up with them. Definitely not. I joined up with them to be with people, like.
What's your game, then? Hang on a minute, will I drop my nose? We've got here, man. How many teams we got here? There's one.
That's six.
It's a real shame. It's a real shame, Alan. But it's just the media calls them comfort. And the media can call us anything. They can call us trash or hippies, or they can call us anything they want to, like.
Hey, someone's knocking.
All right. What do you want, passports? What about the driver? Yeah, he takes the drivers, and the rest of you have to get off and walk through there. What's that, mate? Well, I can't tell him nothing. He's just filming. He's a dummy.
We came over was to get away from aggression this summer. And quite a lot of people were talking about coming over to France, Lorient. And the thought of going to a festival without hearing these stories all the time and aggression and having things ripped off. And I thought we'd never get it together. And I said, right, I'll believe it when we're on the ferry. We got on the ferry and I said, right, I'll believe it, we're going, we've got it together, we've got the bloody truck to it, MOT, we've got it taxi work. 100% legal, and the French wouldn't let us in. It's a joke. Yeah, you just can't argue. I mean, they have the power. What do you do? You know, get a nice new camper on HP or something, you know? Wear Marks and Spencer's shirts. It's crazy. Just bloody crazy. Their paranoia breeding.
Well, I suppose it's a question of optimism. The Free Festival is gone. The Henge was different, but now that's gone. There's nothing really in its place. And that's a great tragedy, because that's where we made our money before Glastonbury. Glastonbury's a different ballgame. You know, we were providing the atmosphere of the type of fair that has sadly gone. We were still there in our own little sort of niche, providing the atmosphere, perhaps the Free Festival, within a paying festival. Well, I suppose in order to survive, we need to compete with the big business, which now exists at festivals. I would rather take what we've got, which I have a feel for, and to do it abroad and survive through busking, selling a bit of beer, a bit of cider perhaps, a bit of wine, and entertaining, just through our own personalities, basically. I think that's quite essential for us to entertain, to be creative. I would rather go abroad with it, because I can't see much future over here.
I don't think this country's got very much to offer for the traveller, because of all this, I suppose, oppression or whatever. But I mean, it's new ground going abroad, isn't it?
The only inspired thing I've had recently was to get out of the country.
Greatest inspiration recently was to take the bus across to France for a while.
To have to have a house in one place and that's it, you know, seems horrific.
Yeah,
that's
it.
Oh my
God.
No, yeah,
no. It's not always, you know, ecstasy living like this, but I couldn't contemplate going back to a house.
You can move abroad by merely driving on and off a boat.
Exactly.
Yeah. You can move. Yeah. Entirely. You can emigrate abroad. All you've got to do is I'm no pun. I'm going anywhere. it's that flexible. That's why I go anywhere. Yeah.
the voice of the Albion, starting from his sleep. Why roll thy clouds in sickening mists? I can no longer hide the dismal vision of mine eyes. O love and life and light, prophetic dreads urge me to speak. Futurity is before me like a dark lamp. Eternal death haunts all my expectation. Rent from eternal brotherhood, we die and are no more.
People need to tune into something greater than themselves, something which has been created before them. They're just part of it. They are continuing mankind's vision, if you like, mankind's quest. It doesn't matter whether you've got a super-duper rig or you live in a little hole in the ground or a little bender or whatever you do. It's the contentment that can come with sharing something which is greater than each and every one of us, as opposed to sort of straight society, if you like, which doesn't seem to me to be involved in anything of that nature. They're into sort of saying, OK, if we develop this technology, then this will happen and we'll all be better off. Well, of course, it doesn't work like that. Unless there's some sort of contact deeper than that, then basically things just fall in apart. Now, obviously, people can only do things right the way they see them. But I believe that if each and every member of the travelling community is coming from their hearts, then this will be a tremendous thing for the whole travelling people. And everyone will feel that they are working together. Then this is when you get into areas of trust, which for communities or groups of people to survive, trust is absolutely essential. But your foundation is very, very strong. And that's very important. See, this is the thing. I believe that travelling people really have to be prepared to take that sort of thing on board. If they want to make fundamental changes in the consciousness of this planet, if they want to fulfil the rainbow prophecies, if they want to be part of the rainbow warrior cycle, the whole movement, if they believe that, then this is the kind of discipline and understanding that they have to be involved in. But if we believe that we have got insights, if we believe we can actually lead people into a better way of living, then we have got to really make tremendous personal sacrifices for the common good. It's no longer what we want as individuals or even as groups. It is the need of humanity and of the whole organism of the earth is so great. And if we can actually get into that, if we can tune into that need, then we're in with a chance, aren't we? I think we're in with a chance.
Across Europe and Asia to China and Japan, like lightnings they go forth and return to Albion on his rocky couch. Gwendolyn, Ragan, Sabrina, Goneril, Mehetabel, Cordella, Boudica, Conwenna, Estrild, Gwynnefryd, Ignoga, Campbell, binding Jerusalem's children in the dungeons of Babylon. They play before the armies, before the hounds of Nimrod, while the Prince of Light on Salisbury Plain among the Druid stones.
It
It's a beautiful setting here, however, I feel totally out of place. I do not feel at my ease here. I'm restless, uneasy. It's okay to come and work on the vehicle here, but it's not the right setting. I don't want to be isolated on my own, surrounded by houses and chalets all around me. I'd like to be on a site with a few other people.
I don't think the average person would believe that, you know, you could have your vehicle smashed up at any time, you know, for doing absolutely nothing apart from being in a vehicle and being different. You know, I have a horror of this being impounded and all my hard work I've put into saving of a virtual wreck, you know, and it to be utterly trashed by the police and there's a, you know, an edge drug search or something like that. But it could quite easily happen. They smashed the inside of the white one to pieces at Nostell Priory. Nostell Priory is the site of an old priory and there's a large sort of mansion house there and lots of grounds and they had a festival in it. And then the police started surrounding it with vans full of police just watching and observing. And on Wednesday, that's when they did a raid on the site and they just carried literally everybody off, wrecked a lot of the vehicles severely. Some, you know, never ever went again. Lots of people went from Nostell Priory to Molesworth. I was a little time incarcerated and couldn't go, but my dog and van went for me.
Yeah,
yeah, my van and dog made it to Molesworth. Yeah.
I think it was August in 84. There was a green gathering at Molesworth, and after the festival, there was a spontaneous decision to stay on the site and squat the land, which at that time was owned by the Department of the Environment, although it was later sold to the Ministry of Defence, so that they were then able to evict us. But before the eviction took place, a group of us went to CND in London and asked for their support of a boycott of American goods based around Molesworth. And we felt that they should have supported the peace camp, but they said they were afraid of being accused of being anti-American. So they didn't give us any support. All they did was hold a wake for the eviction after we were thrown out. I feel that we're being very naive in our approach to getting America to remove their bases from this country, because to my mind there doesn't seem to be any basis for a healthy relationship. It appears to be totally diabolical for both countries and for the world. Molesworth was the largest spontaneous squat since Winstanley took over St George's Hills with the diggers in the 17th century. And the socialists of Great Britain totally missed it.
Well, about 1 o'clock they pulled out and went south down the direction of Stonehenge. And myself and my neighbour John Moore followed along on my motorbike. It was just like a carnival, 95 vehicles long or however long it was. Police helicopter buzzing overhead. I mean, flags were flying, warm sunny afternoon, people stopped and came out of their shops and the houses and sort of waved from upstairs windows. And it was an extraordinary, sort of happy, I said again, carnival atmosphere. Anyway, I was told that the head of the convoy got the roadblock. They ran down the lines of the vehicles, telling people to get out, and if they weren't fairly quick in responding, they had the windscreen smashed and side screen smashed. Other groups started by smashing up the vehicle and then going around to the occupant, telling him to get out. The most notable of those was a light blue ambulance, driven by a young blonde girl. Two of the officers reached inside and grabbed her by the hair and tried to pull her out head first through the broken window over the broken glass that they had broken 5 seconds earlier. All the vehicles then piled into the field, and the police, with the attitude to all that, was extremely laid back. What I had heard, of course, was they were using all that afternoon to bring in troops from every corner of the county. I later learned that they did have firearms present because they thought the convoy was armed. On the stroke of 7 o'clock, a large number of police officers, several hundred anyway, in absolutely full riot gear with all that implies, came in. They took off their helmets and slung them at the vehicles. They slung their truncheons through the windows at the vehicles. They took off their plastic riot shields, trying to chuck them through these already smashed windscreens in order to hit the driver. There is a coach whizzing round. It suddenly comes to a halt. A woman comes up to the front of the coach, in full view of everyone, carrying her baby, and screams to the police who are all rushing out to it. Can't you see the women and children in here actually holding the baby out in a very melodramatic way, showing it to the police. There's a very brief pause, all the police all suddenly slightly taken aback, and then seconds later that windscreen is smashed by a police officer, and the glass just explodes all over that woman and her baby. There came a point when there was only one bus still going around.
We were listening to the helicopter conversation up in the forest when that was happening. They were planning on shooting the drone.
I can imagine, because the chap vanished into the thin air, and he's got, in a sense, will stay vanished into the thin air.
Yeah.
Because if the law ever get their hands on him, they will crucify him. Anyway, but for some reason, I don't quite understand, that vehicle did come to a halt and was immediately set upon by 40, 50, 60 policemen. At that point, the police were out of control and they boiled into that bus, boots first, feet first, the most mindless violence, and some of the scenes of savagery, as they were for it, vented on that bus were way beyond anything I'd ever seen before. And there were scores, hundreds perhaps, of unmarked, unnamed, unlettered policemen in that field, as well as MOD police. Some of the earlier court cases that came to court were immediately thrown out because it not being anything remotely military down there, the MOD actually had no right to be down there in the first place. Finally, we walked back up the field, back to where I'd left my motorbike. John Moore says that he walked past a group of policemen sitting on the grass at that point, and they were saying, "God, that was really good, wasn't it? God, you should have seen the one I got him. Got him right on the back of the neck. Beautiful shot that was." And this sort of thing. I'm told that they arrested something like 580 people that day. I'm told that is the biggest single civilian arrest ever made in this country, which includes two world wars. On the Sunday morning, a fairly senior police officer said to me, "Can I have your permission to send in the troops to, quote, finish unfinished business?" He said, "For this sort of operation, we like to have twice as many attackers as defenders. It would mean 400 people, and to use again his own words, they would have to be, quote, suitably equipped." I said, "If you ask me to sanction a repeat performance of what happened yesterday on my own land, then the answer is an emphatic no."
Do you recognise this man?
No. Looked something of a nasty piece of work. If I had to guess, I would say it was the guy who is responsible for getting that petition together, the legal steps, who turned out to be a paid member of the National Front.
What struck me as somebody who monitored the activities of Leslie Lutzvorn for 25 years was to find that a man who had a very strong Nazi past with international connections, sometimes with people engaged in right-wing terrorism, and a conviction for firearms offences, should be taken on board by local landowners, farmers, and the local authority to some degree, to move on and clear off what they clearly saw and interpreted as lawless elements. Here was a man who in his own right is a lawless element, being given this job. The other thing is, of course, was the story revealed by Nick Davis in The Observer at the time of the offer made by Vaughan and his associates of the provision of ammunition and arms to some of the travellers. Fortunately, it was rejected. But looking at the events of June 85 and how close it came to the police actually physically killing people in that field, one can only have a horrific vision of what might have happened if any of the travellers had taken up Vaughan's offer of guns and ammunition. The Savernake seems to have a real attraction for Vaughan and his friends. In the mid-70s, Vaughan was using the code name Warren, which was based on the name of the house he lived in the Savernake, Warren Lodge. And it's not the first time that Vaughan's been involved in this kind of dirty tricks. And in some ways, it's just incredible that there were no charges brought against Vaughan as a result of his activities down there.
It's just perfectly reasonable, obviously, for people to have a festival in midsummer at Stonehenge. And I would have thought that any government in a civilised society would have recognised that that would have been a perfectly sensible thing to do. And especially in Wiltshire, when there's thousands and thousands of acres of land that isn't being used, you know, just for tanks to roll over and fire blanks at each other, you know, it's a ridiculous waste of space, isn't it?
From the point of view of Glastonbury,
the reasons for us wanting Stonehenge to happen is that Glastonbury is much, much too big anyway. And we do feel that we're not in a position to accommodate a free festival here, which is what we did in 1986. We had several thousand people here that didn't pay to come in because they would have otherwise gone to Stonehenge. But when it became known that the convoy were coming here and they could come, it was actually a problem with insurance, funnily enough. And it was this news at 10 that was causing the problem. They were trying to say like it was the end of the world, medieval brigands and all that stuff. And I was playing it all down and saying, well, we've had people like this for years. And this insurance bloke got on the phone the next morning and said the insurance is off, so you're having people like that. So we had to stage a convoy leaving exercise for the TV, and we gave them a few tickets, for people who wanted to come back. They drove off right on cue. We got the TV cameras down, BBC, ITN and ITV, and filmed these people leaving. And I was being a very reasonable bloke, so waving them goodbye and things. We sorted out the insurance, and in fact, the festival itself actually worked quite well. Despite of all the suggestions about the problems and things, it did actually work quite well. When you put it to the people at the end of the day that they have to leave because the cows are back out on the fields, they always go. I've never had a problem with people staying. But the farmers are afraid of people not moving because they don't know how to talk to them, that's the thing. But the idea of people destroying land is ridiculous. A pack of hounds and a whole lot of horses hunting can do a lot more damage.
I wonder how it's going to affect groups of people this year, all these new bills which have been passed, and which the most important is any groups of more than 12 vehicles. Is it not the 12 vehicles? Is the maximum permitted number of vehicles to travel in a group at any one time? Yeah, you're specifically applying to the vehicle type itinerants.
Yeah.
I mean, you get vigilante troubles in certain areas, no matter what the prevailing climate is towards, people who live in vehicles.
Since we've been back here on this farm, on this land, we had 30 local people did justifiably fear another, as they call it, hippie invasion. And that's why they turned up here with their sticks. And they wanted us to go.
Right there and then.
Right there and then. And in front of these three children, they made statements like, shoot them. See, it got you a bit frightened, Joe. But anyway, in spite of all this, you see, I just understood that they were afraid, basically. And, if people can look at it that way and feel for others rather than just seeing it from their point of view, we've got nothing to worry about because, in fact, we're still here.
A sight taken by a group of people on common land, the atmosphere, the excitement, the stimulation involved is far more genuine, I suppose, than on land that's been bought. I'm all into, in this country, establishing permanent transit sites in every county in the country. So there's a whole network of sites to visit, and you can pick up and go whenever you feel like going.
You mean like the councils are supposed to provide according to the Act of Parliament?
But, we're in an unusual dilemma because although we fall within the definition of gypsies, we need our own sites, our own transit sites. Mm. Separate from those of the gypsies or other groups like the gypsies.
I once offered to pay rates to get rubbish collected. I was told we can't be seen to be condoning the likes of you. I mean, even if we wanted to sort of pay our way, they wouldn't let us anyway. That's why I'm pretty concerned about A, the public order bill, and B, getting us sites anyway. And as far as I can see, it would be very, very sensible if these councils, seeing as how they don't want to provide us with site, any kind of site that we want would have to be woodland. By the nature of our lifestyle, we need wood. We need dead wood. We can manage woodland because we live by it. If you've only got two people per acre paying £5 a week rent, you're still getting a return of £520 per acre per year. So if they won't provide us with sites, how about giving us a mortgage and we'll provide our own? Mm-hmm. Solve the problem for them. It wouldn't even be that we were sat on that land. I mean, nobody wants to settle, but if we can, know that, I'm going to Kent, there's a choice of three sites there. and you can ring up, you know, who's crowded, who's there, who's what's happening. And if every county had two or three sites and a story, we could build nature trails, we could run organic market gardens. There are ways in which we could really contribute to the community at large if they would stop looking at us as a problem and realise that in fact we're part of the solution. You know, we've come at a good time considering we need dead wood. There's loads of it around because the trees are dying. Land is dying. People are trying to take too much from it for profit. And they forget, they think they can cheat. Yeah. You can't cheat on the earth. Western industrialised lifestyle, to me, is proven to be dangerously pollutant. It has proven itself to be that. So why are they persecuting us for trying to find another way?
Let the slave grinding at the mill run out into the field. Let him look up into the heavens and laugh in the bright air. Let the enchained soul shut up in darkness and in sighing, whose face has never seen a smile in 30 weary years. Rise and look out! His chains are loose, his dungeon doors are open, and let his wife and children return from the oppressor's scourge. They look behind at every step and they believe it is a dream. Singing, the sun has left its blackness and found a fresher morning, and the fair moon rejoices in a clear and cloudless night. For empire is no